The first speaker is Professor Gio Rubino. He is Professor of Mechanical Engineering and Associate Dean of the Faculty in PSE Division and COST. He is co-organizer of this workshop and the President of SESCOM, Saudi Arabian Society for Composite Materials. Professor Gio Rubino has a broad research interest, including integrity of composite materials and structures, identification of constitutive parameters, multi-scale coupling technique, and multifunctional materials and devices. Today, he will give a talk about towards high performance adhesive bonding by substrate and or adhesive texturing.
Hello, welcome again to each of you to the Future Composite Conference. It's a real pleasure to have all of you here today and to present our work on high performance adhesive bonding by substrate and or adhesive texturing. So this work has been done in my laboratory at CAOS, the Laboratory of Mechanics of Composites for Energy and Mobility. And I want to associate to this presentation five of my team members, Arif Yudanto, Ran Tao, Ahmed Wagi, Xiao Lili, and Majid Hashem, who have been doing most of the work that is presented today. I also want to be thankful to CAOS for the funding that made this work possible in the framework of the Collaborative Research Grant CRG6. So what about bonding? We all know that adhesive bonding is becoming increasingly important today in aeronautics, in civil engineering, in energy engineering, like for example, wind blades, wind turbine blades, or in automotive engineering, because we need more and more metal to composite assembly or composite to composite assembly. If we look at the conventional fastening technologies, but we are using rivets or bolts, they are facing obvious limitations today, because they are introducing more stress concentrations, they increase a lot the weight. From an economical point of view, it's also required quite a lot of work, so it can be quite expensive, and the maintenance and repair is not so convenient. So there is a big push today to be able to go towards integral adhesive bonding, and typically what we call secondary bonding, in which we have parts that are already pre-processed, and then we come to assemble them by using an adhesive joint in between an adhesive layer in between the two parts. The only problem in this today is that it's quite difficult to measure the performance and the initial strength of the joint of the adhesive layer. And it can give a quite brittle response. That means this is working very well until the time where it doesn't work at all and it breaks right away in a brittle fashion. And this performance is quite sensitive to the surface preparation of the substrate. So today you can use many mechanical treatments that can introduce a lot of variability, or chemical treatment that are based on chemical and chemistry that can be quite aggressive. And there are here health and safety concerns, and there is clearly a need for new ways of preparing the substrate for secondary bonding. How do you reduce the brittleness of the joint? So I just want to quickly review four strategies that exist in the literature today. So the first strategy is to introduce some corrugated substrate. So this is typically here the work of Surface, of the work of Cordisco, in which you introduce some fluctuation in the geometry of the substrate to make sure that you fluctuate between different modes of crack propagation. And this can influence the propagation of your crack and increase the crack propagation resistance of your system. This first strategy sometimes can be quite aggressive. So here, for example, you have the work of Yukimoto, in which you are introducing some corrugation of the CFRP substrate. And you see that this corrugation of the CFRP substrate does not only introduce some mod mixity, but can also introduce some interlock, in which the crack propagation comes with breaking part of the substrate. So you can understand why this is going to increase a lot the crack propagation resistance. But of course, this can be efficient, but it introduces a strong perturbation of the substrate that can be a problem for the cost, for the global performance, and also for the qualifications, the integrity of the substrate. This is quite aggressive when it comes to the modification of the substrate. The second strategy that is very well known in the literature is about introducing some Z reinforcement, and especially what you call Z pinning. So you are going to use an ultrasonic gun to inject some Z pin. This same thing, you know that you have some problems with the perturbation of the fiber arrangement and in the integrity of the substrate. The first strategy is to introduce some interlock. So this is typically what is done by the team at Imperial College, by the team of Sylvestre Pinot, in which you can interlock the plies together. Of course, here it's also very efficient, but you have the question of the integrity of the substrate. What about the introduction of new mechanisms of damage by this pre-cut and interlock system? And finally, the fourth strategy that you will find in the literature is about hybridizing the material and especially introducing some blend of thermoplastic and thermoset, for example, by electrospinning of thermoplastic fibers or by insertion of thermoplastic strip. This seems to be a promising path for the toughening, but there is a need for more integration in an engineering systems and a better integration that I will show today. So what I will show today is about our strategy that is all based on promoting long-range bridging and non-local toughening. So that means we are going to use the adhesive layer to promote what you call long-range bridging like this. So that means ligaments that are going to bridge both sides of the both substrate, and this non-local bridging is going to participate a lot to the toughening and to the toughening of the joint. So we have three main challenges in what we want to do today. The first one is to improve the intrinsic performance of the adhesive joint, but I will say this is not really our main concern. What we want is really to change the failure from brittle to progressive by design. So to make sure that we have a progressive failure and to make sure that we have the time to react, to inspect, and to maintain in case there is a need for maintenance. And we also want to do this, and this is very important to us, without compromising the substrate. That means we want to have an all-in adhesive concept. Ideally, we want to only modify the adhesive to make sure that we can modify the global response of the joint. So I will show here three strategies. The first one is by structuring, if you have an adhesive layer here, by structuring the interface between the adhesive and the substrate. So this is the first technology. So second technology is going to be by structuring the adhesive itself. So we are going to use an hybrid adhesive. So either by using an additive approach. So here the adhesive will be made of a blend of thermoset and thermoplastic, or we are going to use a subtractive approach. So where the adhesive is going to include some sacrificial quarks, but will also promote the toughening of the joint. So I will review these two strategies, strategy one, strategy 2A, and strategy 2B. So first, strategy one, structuring the adhesive substrate interface. So here you need to have a way to modify the interface between the adhesive layer and the substrate. In all the work that I will present today, we are doing this by using laser irradiation. So I will just quickly refresh in two slides what is the effect on laser irradiation and CFRP. Of course, that will be a very, very, very quick overview. We are using here a very classical CO2 laser system. You have plenty of different lasers that you can use for CFRP, but this is the one that we use constantly here. Depending on the fluence that you are using for this laser system, so that means the irradiation by unit of time and by unit surface, you can change the way you are going to modify the surface of your CFRP. So for example, if you are using low irradiation, you are just going to make a surface cleaning and just vaporization of the resin of the surface. If you are using a higher fluence, you can completely vaporize the resin on the surface of the CFRP and you can expose the fibers if you want. So that means by tailoring the fluence of your laser, you can modify the local morphology, you can include more roughness, you can expose the fibers, you can introduce some interlocking low scale feature where your resin of the interface is going to come to interlock with the substrate, or you can also modify a lot the weighting properties. So if you look at the weighting plane, of course, here you have the initial weighting plane before laser treatment, and you are increasing a lot this weighting plane when you are treating with a laser system. So you are going to increase improve your weighting properties. Another effect of the classical effect of laser treatment is that, of course, you are going to modify the functionality of your surface. So you are going to introduce more polar groups on the surface, and this is going to promote your adhesion. And at the same time, you are going to clean a lot your surface. And especially here, you see the gray bars is the level of contaminant on your surface. And you see that when you are introducing laser treatment, you reduce a lot the quantity of silicon on your surface that is well known to be a contaminant, because if you look, the toughness of your joint is inverse proportional to the content of contaminant over the surface. So your laser treatment can clean your surface, can polarize your surface, and can remove any kind of contaminant that you had already at the beginning of your treatment. And what is very important is that depending on the level of fluence, the level of energy that you are using, you can give different surface property at different location. So now, how can I use this to control bridging by selective patterning? So we are going to start by a very quick numerical study. So imagine that I'm taking a DCP beam like this. So this DCP beam is made of two CFRP substrate. And then here I have an adhesive layer that is a bulk adhesive layer. And this layer is connected to the substrate by two layers of cohesive element. Cohesive element that can have two properties, the light green properties with relatively low strength and low toughness, and the dark green properties here with high strength and high toughness. And then we are going to see how this system is responding to the propagation of a crack here at the bottom of the adhesive system, depending on the relative values of the dark green and the light green properties. Of course, the very classical response that you can have is the crack that is propagated at the beginning is the crack that is starting at the bottom here is going to propagate along the bottom interface and will go across the dark green region without any change. So here you have a tougher region. So what you will see is that you will get your P delta curve of the DCB response, and you get the initial one. And then when you go through the tougher area, you get an improvement of the performance here. And then when you go completely across the dark green area, you come back to the initial response of the system. So this is the classical response. Is there is nothing special in your system. But what is interesting is that now if you start modifying the relative values of the green and the dark green and light green area, you can completely change the system. The crack is propagating at the bottom of your interface here. And then when the crack is going to reach the crack arrest fetcher, you are going to see the development of a secondary crack, a bifurcation of the crack to the top interface. And you have the creation of a ligament between the bottom interface and the top interface here. And you see that now your DCB curve is going to show a lot of improvement because you are storing a lot of energy in this adhesive ligament. So when you are doing this, typically you have the crack that is propagating at the bottom here at the beginning. When the crack is reaching the crack RS feature here, there is initiation of a secondary crack on the top, and you have propagation of two cracks, one on the top and one on the bottom. And on the DCB curve, this is going to look like a very important improvement of the effective toughness of your joint, and you have a huge improvement of the response of your DCB. So this is a perfect situation in which, of course, you are able to create a ligament that survive, but you have plenty of situation in which your ligament is going to break during this propagation. You cannot sustain a very long infinite ligament. So in this case, you will get an improvement, but a very local improvement at the beginning. And then at some point, your ligament is going to break, and part of the elastic energy that was stored in your ligament will be dissipated during the failure of this ligament. So you have basically, depending on the way you tune the properties between the light green and the dark green, you have basically three different responses: propagation on one interface, initiation of a secondary crack and creation of a ligament, or initiation of a secondary crack and creation of a ligament that is going to break. And based on extensive numerical simulation, what we have been able to show is that the case 2A, that is of course the most interesting, is completely guided by the contrast in strength and the contrast of toughness between the light green and the dark green. And you want to have a minimum contrast in strength to make sure when you arrive here, you are going to initiate, you are going to have a weak interface on the top so you can initiate the secondary crack. And you want at the same time to make sure that the contrast in toughness is not too big to make sure that you are not going to break your ligament too quickly. If you control correctly your contrast in strength and contrast of toughness, that you can do with the laser treatment, you can start to verify this experimentally. And this is typically the same system, but experimental system in which you have a series of laser treatment. So the dark green area is what you see here in light gray. So that means high fluence. And when you introduce a pattern of tough, less tough, and so laser treatment. And this is what you observe during the propagation of your crack. So you see the propagation of the crack on the bottom. Here it's a moving film to follow the crack propagation. And you see that when the crack is propagating, you are initiating plenty of secondary crack initiation, ligaments, and crack bifurcation. So this is going, of course, to increase a lot the response of your DCB system. And this is what you see at the end, your P delta curve. You see that you are getting a joint that is much more progressive from the beginning to the end. Here, you have the accumulation of events of secondary crack propagation here. And this is the identified macroscopic toughness of your system. And you see that you can improve the microscopic toughness to 0.3 to almost one. So there is a very huge improvement that is due to the energy that you are using to break this different ligament, this cascade of ligament that you are creating from the beginning. This concept has been also validated in mode two. So this is something that will be presented more in detail by Ahmed Waghi during his postdoc presentation on Wednesday. But you see here, even if the mechanisms locally is not exactly the same, you will see that there is a big improvement between the baseline curve and the improved system due to the patterning. And Ahmed will explain the physics behind this in detail. Of course, since it works in mode one and mode two, you can start to use it to study some more complicated structures. So here we have the example of a stiffener, a T joint. And you see the propagation shear at the root of the T joint. And you see here the development of multiple ligaments in this interface that has been laser treated. Here you have the load displacement curve that you will see with a CFRP presentation without any care of the laser patterning. And here you have what you observe after the laser patterning, and you see that the improvement of the curve is very well correlated to the different bridging event that appeared during the failure of the T-joint. Something that I want to do very quickly today, but the role of randomness is of course very important of this process. Here I show you a very clean experimental verification in which we make a very periodical pattern. But of course, we studied the role of the randomness, and what we have been able to show is that in fact, the alignment and the alignment of the pattern and the periodicity of the pattern is not so important. What is important is to have enough randomness if the properties of the system. So this is something that I invite you to see in our publications. You can see that the improvement in toughness and the improvement in the DCB curve, the way you are creating the ligament, is very related, in fact, to the variance in the strength when you assume that you have stochastic interface properties. And what we have been able to show also numerically is that the alignment between the top surface treatment and the bottom surface treatment is not that important. What is important is to have a minimum contrast in phase. A minimum phase contrast between the top treatment and the bottom treatment. And as long as you have this minimum phase contrast, you are getting the improvement between the initial baseline curve and the improved curve with ligament formation. So this is something that you are going to see with the papers of Shirley, who worked a lot with me on this topic from a numerical modeling point of view. Second strategy now, that is about structuring the adhesive. So now we don't want to modify the interface. We want to modify the adhesive itself. So first approach, the additive approach, that is using an hybrid adhesive. So this is something that we suspected by looking at some papers in the literature. So here you have this work from Hede Jorgensen, in which they show that, for example, if you take a classical adhesive layers in which you have the thermoplastic net that is used classically to handle the adhesive film, you see that you can have some bridging in case of kissing bond. And they already noted that you had an improvement of the DCB curve in that case. You had some work in this direction done by the team of Norman Fleck and Maloney, so in which they try to improve the bonding between metal substrate by introducing a structure adhesive bond line, and here by using copper between two metallic substrates. So we try to improve our technologies by introducing a thermoplastic net inside, but a controlled and well-engineered thermoplastic net inside our adhesive layer. So here we are making by 3D printing a nylon net with a specific geometry, and this nylon net is integrating inside our DCB, and you can see that this is also going to contribute to bridging to a better bridging of the two substrates. So what is very important, why is the nylon net is very important for us, because in the previous strategy that I showed to you, most of the energy is dissipated during the breaking of the ligaments, but of course these ligaments are made of thermoset and are still quite fragile, right? So what is important is to introduce some ductility in this ligament, and this is the role of the nylon net that we are introducing here. What is important is that the performance of this net, and what is new in our work here, is very related to the way you introduce it and to the microstructure of porosities in the interface. Actually, here you see two very striking example. If you are here, you have an example without too much porosity. So that means the nylon net is well connected to the epoxy in the adhesive. Here you have an example with a lot of porosities, and you see that the blue response with the porosities is much, much better compared to the control sample, or to the system without porosities. So having porosities is important. It's very important because porosities are giving the degree of freedom to the thermoplastic to deform and to bring this ductility that you need in the joint. So you really get this increasing R curve during the propagation process. Last technology that I want to discuss today is about structuring the adhesive, but using a substructive approach. That means we are going to use sacrificial quarks. So sacrificial quarks is a concept that has been invented a long time ago, and especially that is based of the concept of shadowing and modification of the energy release rate of the main quark propagation when you have networks or pattern of secondary quarks in a process zone. This is something that has been exploited recently in Imperial College in the team of Sylvester Pino. So in this case, with the example of micro-cutting of composites to introduce more ductility in the joints. What we are doing here is that we are introducing sacrificial quarks in the adhesive bonding. So here you see the adhesive layer in between the two substrates. We are introducing sacrificial quarks by introducing Teflon film at the beginning with some pre-cut. So if you are putting inside your adhesive layer a structured Teflon film with some geometry, this Teflon film, of course, is going to kill the adhesion properties. It's going to be a non-sticky agent, and this is going to introduce a specific geometry of sacrificial quarks inside your system. These sacrificial quarks include some waviness and non-symmetry that I will not disclose today, but are quite important to the efficiency of the system. It's actually a key parameter to make sure that you have something working well. And you see here that compared to the baseline joint, when you start to introduce some sacrificial quarks like this, you are also increasing the toughness of your system. So you are approximately a 60% improvement in an optimal configuration. And this is actually what happened. You have the main quark in mode one. The main quark is propagating here at the beginning. When this is going to get close to the sacrificial quark here, this is going to promote the creation of a backward secondary quark here on the top, failure of a bridging ligament here, and final failure on the bottom here. So you see that the numerical simulation here on the mechanism itself correlates very well with the experimental observation. In mode one, this is something that interestingly works also very well in mode two. You have the same concept of secondary quark bridging and ligament formation in mode two that is participating a lot to the improvement of the properties in mode two in the same way. So you see that the initial system in mode two becomes much more progressive and ductile when you go to mode two. So this is something that will be also presented by Ahmed Waghi in his poster in detail on Wednesday. So as a conclusion, I wanted to summarize on 3 points. First one is that we presented various approaches for manipulating the failure of secondary bonding. The first approach is based on the introduction of heterogeneity on the adhesive substrate interface. Here it's done by laser treatment, but honestly, we could use many different techniques to structure this interface, like typically wall-to-wall printing. And this is something that we are developing now. Then introduction of adhesive heterogeneities in the interface by introduction of this thermoplastic net. And third path, introduction of sacrificial quark in the interface by using a pre-engineered Teflon film. So all these technologies here, they are all compatible with what I call an all-in adhesive concept. So that means at the end, we just want to modify the adhesive. And the adhesive is something that is going to be a highly engineered adhesive system, in which we come with all the techniques coming together. So that means patterning of the interface between the adhesive and the substrate, thermoplastic insert to introduce some ductility, and sacrificial quarks to improve against the dissipation. All of them can come together in the same adhesive system, but that can be sold as a standalone product to achieve high quality secondary bonding between composite prepregs. So there are publications that are related to this work. So this presentation is recorded. So I'm sure that you can come back to these slides to get these references, and you can have a look at them if you are interested to know more about this system. So these publications are the result of a three-year contract on these technologies. So of course, we cover both experimental and computational aspect on these toughening strategies. And you are very welcome to write us if you want to get any of this publication. I wanted to thank you for listening to these presentations. Of course, you can ask me any question on my email anytime. This is the website of the lab, composites.chaos.edu.sa. So you are very welcome to come there to discover our latest research directions. You can also follow us on Twitter. So there is a Twitter for the lab that is here. And you are very welcome to visit us anytime. So this is one of the main archaeological features in Madain Saleh. So one of the big Nabatean fonts that you can discover in the north of the kingdom. And there are many jewels to discover in Saudi Arabia for anybody who wants to come back to visit us as soon as the COVID situation is going to ease a little bit. Thank you very much for your attentions, and I wish you a very good workshop. Very good workshop with us in the following days.
Yeah, I have a question from the Q&A. So thanks for the creative ideas. In one of the approach, you use the thermoplastic nets to improve the performance. How did you select it? And the second question from him is, in order to have high strength and high toughness, do you recommend using two different adhesives together?
Okay, thank you very much. You can see my screen here. Yeah. So when you are using to the net technology here, what is important is really to make sure that you can, in fact, you have three phases together. You have the CFRP substrate, you have the epoxy adhesive that is inside the adhesive layer, and then you have the thermoplastic that you are using for the reinforcement. And what is important is to be able to tune each adhesion separately, because you want to have a relatively good adhesion between the adhesive and the substrate, but you want to have a relatively weak adhesion between the thermoplastic and the thermoset adhesive. So all of this is going to guide a lot your choice for the thermoplastic phase. So you have a couple of thermoplastic that can make the job. Here it's nylon, because of course it's one of the most classical printable thermoplastics, and you can treat it in a way that you get a good adhesion with either liquid epoxy. So this was mainly the selection, the possibility to tune the adhesion with the liquid epoxy. And then in order to have high strength and high toughness, do you recommend using two different adhesives together? But what is really important is to make sure that you control your fragmentation process. I come back a little bit to the very good presentation from Michael Wisdom before. The whole point is to make sure that you are controlling in a sequential way and a progressive way the way of materially fragmenting. So you can use different phases together. Here you have two phases, a thermoset and a thermoplastic, but you can imagine more complex systems that are going to make the job.
Okay, thank you. Thank you again for Professor Gio Lubino.